three major challenges that have faced humankind since the beginning of time. They are ignorance, poverty, and ill health. We can remove ignorance through education. We can eliminate poverty through economics. But unless we do something to relieve the pressures of ill health, people are generally not motivated to do much about their ignorance or their poverty. That's why it is the new health care reform law that is an essential part of our development going forward. The new health care reform law, officially the Patient Protection Affordable Care Act and the Health Care and Education Reconciliation Act, is transforming the patchwork of U.S. mental health care financing system of yesterday. This is a system that left 47 million dependent on a sparse network of overburdened and under-resourced safety net providers into a complex set of arrangements that by 2014 will cover nearly all U.S. citizens. The Affordable Care Act, as the new law is called, represents a major advance in the long march toward health care for all and will increase access and quality of health care for all citizens. The law also contains important provisions that specifically address minority health disparities. Hello, I'm Howard Lee, Executive Director of the North Carolina Education Cabinet and advisor to North Carolina Governor Beverly Perdue. Today's 16th Annual Public Health Research Institute and Video Conference on Minority Health asks the question, what will health care reform mean for minority health disparities? For answers, we call on health disparities experts around the country and in our studio, including three panelists with intimate knowledge of different aspects of this topic. Before I introduce our panelists, I need to recognize and thank the people and organizations that have made today's broadcast possible. The full list is posted at www.minority.unc.edu and will appear at the end of the program. At this time, though, we extend a very special thank you to two patron sponsors: the Dean's Office of the UNC Jennings School of Global Public Health, led by Dean Barbara Reimer, and UNC Diversity and Multicultural Affairs, led by Associate Provost Archie Irvin. Thank you very much, Dean Reimer and Dr. Irvin. We also express our deep appreciation to the Norfolk State University Etheline R. Strong School of Social Work for their generous co-sponsorship, and to Dean Dorothy Brown, who along with Drs. Lloyd Edwards and Trudy Bennett, founded the UNC Minority Health Project and launched the annual Institute and Video Conference. We also thank the UNC School of Social Work and Dean Jack Richmond for inviting us back to the Tate Turner Carrot Auditorium. This auditorium is named in honor of UNC's first African-American dean, Dr. John Turner. Dr. Turner devoted his life to community organization, social activism, and social work, education, and the School of Social Work, in which I'm a proud alumnus. And also, home to the UNC's first African-American faculty member, Dr. Hortense McClinton. We're grateful to the chancellor of this great university, the outstanding leader, and a man with probably one of the busiest schedules in North Carolina, Dr. Holland Thorpe, for taking time from that busy schedule to come and join us in the auditorium today. At this time, I recognize Dr. Thorpe.
Thank you. Thank you, Howard. It's a privilege to be with you, and it's a great occasion that we're all here. Welcome to the University of North Carolina at Chapel Hill. Welcome to everyone here, and welcome to the participants around the country. For those of you joining us by video, it's a beautiful day in Chapel Hill. So I hope it is where you are too. This is the 16th annual Summer Public Health Research Video Conference on Minority Health. And it is an honor for us to host this conference and to show our dedication to the subjects that you'll be talking about. As Senator Lee said, I'd like to thank the Barbara Reimer from the UNC Gilling School of Global Public Health, and also Archie Irvin from the Office of Diversity and Multicultural Affairs for their support of this. And I'd like to recognize two great champions of this issue on our campus, Dr. Cookie Newsom, who's the Director of Diversity Education and Research, and Dr. Vic Schoenbeck, Associate Professor of Epidemiology in the Gilling School of Global Public Health. Vic and Cookie, thank you very much for all you've done. And as Senator Lee also said, we appreciate the support we've gotten from the Ethel and R. Strong School of Social Work at Norfolk State University and their dean, Dorothy Brown. There are 1,000 participants in this conference in at least 40 states, and a great audience here in Chapel Hill. So I think it's obvious that the interest and importance of this topic are well recognized here in Chapel Hill, and we're, as I said, happy to help promote that. As an institution, we are critically involved in the issue of health disparities across the School of Public Health, the School of Medicine, the School of Social Work, and throughout the social sciences. In my role as Chancellor, I spend a lot of time talking about the world's greatest problems and how we can mobilize our institution to solve those great problems. And certainly inequality is one of the great problems that are facing our nation and our world, and our faculty are dedicated to helping to promote solutions to inequality across all areas, but especially in health disparities, where we study the impact of environmental hazards on minority communities, research disparities in breast cancer survival, and have been working with African American barbershops to promote cancer screening. We are putting our expertise to work to address these disparities. And I know all of us hope that healthcare reform will take us a long way into solving these problems. And we are, of course, as all of you, excited about the healthcare reform law and eager to see how it will play out and how we can use these changes to help address healthcare disparities across our nation. So I'm glad that so many of you could participate via technology and here in person, and I'm proud to be part of the great work that Senator Lee and Cookie and Vic and all of our colleagues have done. So thank you for, welcome to Chapel Hill, and thank you for being here.
Thank you so much, Chancellor Thorpe. We appreciate all you've doing to lead this great university and to give us an opportunity to come and be a part of this wonderful experience here in Chapel Hill today. Now I would like to introduce our panelists, and I would ask that you hold your applause until I've introduced all three. Our first presenter will be Ms. Mara Alvarez. Ms. Alvarez is a legislative assistant to Senator Richard Durbin, the Majority Whip of the U.S. Senate and the senior senator from Illinois. She previously served as a legislative assistant for former Congresswoman Hilda Solis, who is now Secretary of Labor. Ms. Alvarez has also been chair of the Health Task Force for the Congressional Hispanic Caucus and worked as a David Winston Health Policy Fellow in the office of then-Senator Barack Obama. Ms. Alvarez graduated from the University of California at Berkeley and holds a Master's of Health Administration from the UNC Gilling School of Global Public Health, where she was co-president of the Minority Student Caucus. Ms. Alvarez will be the first and will open our session at the proper time by summarizing the key points of the healthcare reform plan law that will affect minority health disparities. Our second presenter will be Mr. Ralph Ficarra. Mr. Ficarra is executive director for the Seattle Indian Health Board, one of the most comprehensive urban Indian community centers in the nation. He is a member of the Huayno Band of Mission Indians, a state-recognized Indian tribe from the San Juan Capistrano region of Southern California. Mr. Ficarra is a clinical assistant professor with the School of Public Health Department of Health Sciences at the University of Washington. He is president of the Community Health Council of Seattle, King County, and immediate past chair of the American Indian, Alaska Native, and Native Hawaiian Caucus of the American Public Health Association. He is the urban representative to the American Indian Health Commission for Washington State and has been an activist with several national healthcare advocacy groups. Mr. Fakara has a master's in public health from California State University, Northridge. Our third presenter will be Dr. Tony Whitehead, a senior professor and former chairperson in the Department of Anthropology at the University of Maryland, College Park. Dr. Whitehead's research expertise includes methods for applied ethnographic research for community and cultural assessment. He has applied cultural theories from anthropology, sociology, community psychology to his work. He's worked in the United States, the Caribbean, Africa, and Europe on issues such as urban violence, crime, incarceration, and community reentry. Dr. Whitehead holds a bachelor's degree in sociology from right here in North Carolina's Shaw University and a master's of science in hygiene and public health and a PhD in anthropology, both from the University of Pittsburgh. Please join me in extending a warm North Carolina welcome and a hearty UNC welcome to our distinguished panelists. Each of our panelists will speak for about 20 minutes and will come back to the podium in the order in which they were introduced. After our panelists have finished their remarks, we will take a five-minute break. During that break, we will rearrange the stage and will prepare to take questions and comments from online and from right here from our studio participants. So that we might be able to include as many questions as possible, I urge you to limit your remarks to 2 minutes or less. If you think of a question during the presentation, those of you who are watching off-site, you can send it to question@unc.edu or via web form at www.minority.unc.edu/question, or write it down, and you may even call it in during the discussion portion of the program, and we will respond to your questions and have that response from the appropriate presenter. The Affordable Health Care Act is the greatest transformation of health care financing in over 40 years. I would like to invite now Mrs. Alvarez to tell us about key provisions of that act, especially as they relate to minority health disparities and what we should be looking for going forward. And now I want to recognize Mrs. Alvarez. I do, however, want to recognize the fact that yesterday was a very special day in her life in that it was her birthday. But I'm not allowed to ask her how old she is. I can tell you that as a person with whom I've been impressed since we've been together, as a young person, she has made a tremendous impression upon me, but her record of accomplishment is outstanding. Ms. Alvarez, thank you for being with us today.
Thank you, Senator Lee, for that introduction. When I was invited to speak and I saw the date, I remember just smiling to myself, thinking, it's the day after my birthday, okay. Mm-hmm. And the reason I smiled is because what better way to celebrate my time on Earth than to talk about what inspires me the most and what I have been living and breathing for the past 2 years of my life. As a congressional staffer, I sat in many meetings. I talked and discussed specific provisions of the 2,500-page bill. I briefed my boss on many of the specific provisions, but I didn't have a lot of opportunities to really talk about what inspires me the most, about minority health, and particularly about the impact that federal policy has on communities of color. There are not many opportunities for legislative staff to do that. So I'm really lucky to be able to be here today, especially when I get to come back home. I graduated from the University of North Carolina, Chapel Hill, just a few years ago. So I'm very familiar with, actually the campus is very different. It's changed a lot in the last few years. But I've sat where you sat, and I've listened to this video conference year after year. So it's great to be able to come back home and be able to talk about this with you. So I especially want to thank Vic Schoenbach and the entire planning committee of the video conference for inviting me to be here today. And I want to give special recognition to my dear friend, Dr. Sadie Paez Erickson, who without her recommendation, I probably wouldn't even have been invited to be here. So thank you very much for allowing me this time to be with you. I really do appreciate it. So it was my birthday yesterday. And the one thing that I love about birthdays is that it's a new year. You're celebrating a new beginning. You get to have this renewed sense of passion for what the next year is going to hold for you and what's going to lie ahead. So the passage of the new health reform law felt like my birthday coming early this year. It's a new beginning for healthcare as we know it in our country. So today, during my time with you, I want to talk a little bit about why we needed healthcare reform, particularly as it relates to communities of color. I'll discuss some of the specific details of the Affordable Care Act, and specifically the health disparities provisions that we think are going to make a difference for the future health of people of color. And I'll close it out with a little bit of my thoughts on where I think we're going and how we, as advocates for the elimination of health disparities, can continue to be involved and make sure that implementation of this law is successful. So many of the people in this room have been working toward the elimination of healthcare disparities and comprehensive healthcare far longer than I have. Many of those people in this room, including the gentleman with whom I have the honor of sharing this panel, have been working for years on the state of healthcare, and in particular, minority health. We've been at this fight for a while. One president, as quoted in the book Critical by former Senator Tom Daschle, said it like this: "Millions of our citizens do not now have a full measure of opportunity to achieve and enjoy good health. Millions do not now have protection or security against the economic effects of sickness. The time has arrived for action to help them attain that opportunity and that protection." You might guess that these words were from President Obama. In the past couple of years of his term, he's given a lot of speeches, many of them on healthcare, but they weren't. Maybe it was President Clinton in 1994, or even President Kennedy. It wasn't. The words belonged to President Harry Truman as part of a speech he delivered to a joint session of Congress in 1945, promoting his own plan for healthcare. Well, we know how well that turned out. Now, after 60 years and multiple failed attempts, we're in the middle of a successful effort to reform healthcare in our country. Today, the law of our land is the ability for every American to afford quality healthcare coverage, and nowhere will that impact be more apparent than in communities of color. From premature births to premature deaths, people of color disproportionately bear the brunt of our country's broken healthcare system. On average, they live sicker and die sooner and go without needed medical care more often. A couple of statistics that I'm sure all of you know very well. African American infant mortality rate is twice the national average. Black men are nearly twice as likely to have prostate cancer as white men. Latinos in the US are almost twice as likely to die from diabetes than are non-Latino whites. Black women are less likely to survive breast cancer than white women. Communities of color also suffer disproportionately from HIV, heart disease, stroke, and other medical conditions. Just a couple of months ago, these facts were again confirmed in the Agency for Healthcare Research and Quality report on healthcare disparities. In that report, the agency found that disparities still exist across all areas of healthcare: quality, access, types of care, clinical conditions, care settings. The good news is that we have seen some improvements in the quality of care, but disparities continue to persist. For Blacks, Asians, and Latinos, at least two-thirds of the measures of quality of care are not improving. Either the gap is staying the same, or unfortunately, it's getting worse. Disparities are not disappearing, and they're getting worse. We all know they have deep roots, and they're a result of a complicated combination of factors. But a main theme that was apparent in the 2009 report, and a main theme that many of the people in this room see on a day-to-day basis, is the fact that the lack of insurance is an important contributor to healthcare disparities. Today, people of color make up one-third of the U.S. population, but make up more than one-half of the uninsured population. Without health insurance, people are more likely to postpone medical care, or more likely to go without needed medical care, or are not able to afford the prescription medications that they actually need. As a result, what's happening? They're living sicker and they're dying sooner. An unfortunate reality that people of color have endured for far too long. The passage of this law, the passage of the Affordable Care Act, presents a tremendous opportunity for change. No single law can eliminate all the health inequities in our nation, but the new health reform law will make a significant difference in that direction. It will do more to promote social and economic justice and promote equal access to health care in America than any measure since the passage of the Civil Rights Act and the creation of Medicare. The law is expected to cover 95% of Americans, including 32 million Americans that today have no insurance, have nowhere to go. Communities of color have the most at stake when we were crafting the coverage provisions in this bill. As a result of the high uninsured numbers, they have the potential to benefit the most from this new law. One analysis tells us that 81% of African Americans who are currently uninsured will get coverage, either through Medicaid expansion or government subsidies. 60% of uninsured Latinos and 60% of Asian Pacific Islanders will get coverage. And then, for American Indians, it's especially important. It permanently reauthorized the Health Care Improvement Act, something, an effort that they've been trying to reauthorize and modernize for over a decade. This new law will help make health insurance more affordable, with tax credits for small businesses and subsidies for people who need them. Yes, some of the changes will take time to implement, but some, they're already underway. Just a few weeks ago, 4 million small businesses across our country found a postcard in their mailbox, and that postcard told them that they could be eligible for a health care tax cut this year, a tax cut that could be worth potentially thousands of dollars that would allow their employees to have health insurance coverage, just like all of the large companies are able to offer their employees. Starting this month, businesses will get even more relief for providing coverage to their retirees who are not yet eligible for Medicare. And in another week or so, senior citizens who fall into that prescription drug coverage gap, that donut hole in Medicare, will start receiving a $250 rebate to help them afford their medication. And just how about today? Today, the administration announced that they're going to release $51 million for states to apply for money to be able to review what premium increases insurance companies are announcing so that they can make sure that those premium rate increases are justified and that Americans aren't getting the short end of the stick. That those, if they're going to raise their rates, so be it. But let's make sure they're doing it in a justified way. Starting in July, individuals with pre-existing conditions who today find it impossible to find coverage in the individual market are going to have an option through a high-risk pool. If the state decides they don't want to offer a high-risk pool, then the federal government will step in. That safety net will be there. And in addition to the tangible benefits, the new law will finally give Americans the chance to fight back against insurance company abuses. Insurance companies will be required to cover preventative care. No more discrimination on the basis of pre-existing conditions or the mere fact that you're a woman. A few weeks ago, the entire insurance industry announced that it would comply with the new law early and stop the perverse practice of dropping people's coverage when they get sick. Now, your insurance will be there when you need it, just as it should be, just as we all thought it was. And parents, you'll have the peace of mind to know that your child will have the opportunity to stay on your plan until they're 26 years old. Birthdays are a time of celebration. Parents aren't supposed to worry about their child turning 26 and saying, they're not going to have coverage anymore, turning 22 and they're not going to have coverage. You know, when I graduated undergrad and I was trying to find my first job, was that first job going to offer me health insurance coverage? Probably not. And to have that safety net that I'm going to be able to stay on my parents' plans, that's what we should be offering students. In that time when they're worrying about what job is going to come up, where they're going to be living, they don't need to be worrying about what health plan they're going to get on. Let's give them a couple of years to find that opportunity that's going to present them a good paying job that offers them health insurance coverage. We'll expand Medicaid so to offer all low-income Americans a real safety net, a real security blanket to know that if I ever fall, if I don't have a job, if I don't have the opportunity to make money in order to pay my premiums, then Medicaid will be there as my safety net. And we will create new insurance exchanges where Americans can shop for coverage that fits their needs, giving consumers more choices, but giving insurance companies more competition. This will offer Americans the resources and tools they need to understand a healthcare system that is complex and very difficult to maneuver. How many of us here read all of the fine print in our insurance policy when we get it? How many of us know every single surgery or service that our insurance plan covers? I'm sure many of us in this room, our aunts or our moms or our friends, have called that insurance company or that insurance agent and is asking 500 questions to try to clarify, let me make sure this is covered before I actually go in and ask for this service. The exchange is going to be able to offer Americans clear information about what services are covered so that you're operating a system that you know, that you understand, and that you're able to use to promote positive health behaviors in your life. The exchange will be designed to present Americans a roadmap for navigating their health insurance. And because this marketplace will allow consumers to band together to negotiate lower rates, it's estimated that premiums for many customers will go down 14 to 20% for comparable coverage today. Just like we have eBay and we have Amazon and we know how to, you know, bid for our lowest price, that's exactly what we're going to do with our healthcare, becoming more educated consumers and becoming more in control of our own healthcare. But the people in this room, as good stewards of public health, we know that having a health insurance card does not mean having access. So the health reform bill contains several other measures that will reduce healthcare inequities throughout the country. It provides funding for up to 10,000 new community health centers. We all know far too well the amazing work that community health centers in our communities actually do. And far too often, that woman with a baby on her lap or that family that's coming in through the door of the health clinic is often a family of color. The new law will invest billions of dollars into community health centers so that every family has a real medical home to call their own. It quadruples the size of the National Health Service Corps. These are the very medical professionals that we find in underserved communities and community health centers. The new health reform law expands scholarships and loan repayment programs to encourage more minority students to become health professionals. Today in our country, among America's doctors, 5% are Latino, 4% are African American. The inability for our healthcare professionals to reflect the diversity of our communities is a detriment, not only to the patient, but to the actual working environment of others in the field. We are a strong country because of the diversity of our backgrounds, our thoughts, our ideas, our experiences, and our workplaces, our clinics, our hospitals, our health centers would be stronger with a more diverse pool of healthcare professionals. And this sends a clear message to students in middle school, in elementary school, in high school, that there's a pathway down to medical school. There's a pathway to the School of Public Health available for you. If you need help, we're going to have the programs in place so that you can go into the field that you're looking to do. For the first time since the programs were created, over 10 years ago, the Centers of Excellence and the Health Career Opportunity Program would be reauthorized. These are the programs whose mission it is to recruit and retain students of color in medical schools, schools of public health, schools of dentistry, schools of pharmacy, where we need diverse students to come in and be part of the next generation of healthcare professionals. But the new law not only builds on the existing programs, it brings in many new ideas. The law increases the number of community health workers, not just doctors and nurses, but trained lay people who can work within their communities to help teach others how to protect their health and how to monitor their chronic diseases. Lay health advisors, promotoras, community health workers, whatever title you give them, they're people from the community that are educated and trained to be able to educate and train other people in their community. And because they're from that community, they're more invested and bought into the policy as they want to see it moving forward. They're trusted sources. When you ask around your community or your own family, what's the next step of your healthcare decisions? Where are you going to go seek a doctor? They rely on their personal experiences. So many in communities of color depend on one another for information. The greatest resource we have to reform our healthcare system is really each other. Our communities have a wealth of knowledge to share with this administration. With the administration's renewed commitment to minority health and the elimination of health disparities, we have an opportunity to influence the design of programs and the impact of programs on the areas of the country that need it the most. The reauthorization of the Office of the Minority Health within the Federal Department of Health and Human Services for the first time in 10 years is a signal of that commitment. So too is the creation of the National Institute on Minority Health and Health Disparities. Elevating what was a center to a full status of an institute will give minority health concerned a more powerful voice within the National Institutes of Health. The new law also establishes a Community Preventative Services Task Force, a task force whose job it will be to review existing science and recommend the adoption of certain practices so that the programs moving forward are actually responding to what our communities need. These programs identify what activities will best achieve the goals they identify, including reducing health disparities, working within the community to make a difference. So, the new law is complex and reaches into every aspect of healthcare as we know it. However, I want to make clear that you're not going to find a section that says healthcare for people of color or the elimination of health disparities. Instead, you will find that the new law is, as a whole, dedicated to reducing health disparities simply by virtue of impacting the issues communities of color are most at risk for: being uninsured, not having a regular source of care, and underrepresentation in the health professions. As a staffer who cared about the impact of the law on health disparities, I went back and forth. Would we rather have seen a section of the bill dedicated solely to the issue, or is it better to be located in every aspect of the law? The latter, to me, expressed exactly the shift in how our healthcare system, and frankly, how our elected officials respond to the needs of communities of color. For example, something as basic as improving the federal data collection and what specifically we're asking for is going to better able to target our programs to address the needs of communities of color. No longer will the needs of people of color be relegated solely to an office or a group or a program or a special interest, because we all know just how prominent minority populations are to every corner of this country and every aspect of this law. By 2045, more than half of the U.S. population will be a person of color. It's with this mindset that we begin to shift our focus for the role communities of color must play in shaping the legislative landscape of our country for healthcare and for all issues. And there is so much more to shape. I will be the first to admit, as many others have, this new law is by no means perfect. We could have done many more things. We could have made it a lot bigger. It could have been a lot more expensive. But this is what happens. Medicare, Medicaid, the Civil Rights Act, the Voting Rights Act, critical pieces of social policy that each have been improved over time. So we can't overlook how perfect a first step this actually is. The President and this Congress delivered on making sure that our country, just like every other industrialized country in this world, is offering the security of knowing that if you want health insurance coverage, you can get it. The new law is the biggest expansion in healthcare coverage since Medicare and the biggest middle-class tax cut for healthcare in American history. And it's clear more and more Americans are agreeing. Public opinion polls are shifting. We're starting to see that people are coming around to understand that let's not scrap this bill or this law. Let's work with it. Let's work with it to improve it for the future. So the fight to reform our healthcare system continues. It's easy to step back and criticize a process that took far longer than any of us expected, hundreds of meetings, dozens of votes that seem to have taken us nowhere. Or you can take it as evidence that change is possible, that a group of people working together can make a positive impact on the lives of Americans. But our work is not over, and it is now your involvement and connection to this issue that can best ensure a successful implementation of the law, to ensure that our President, this Congress, your member of Congress, can continue to lead our country in the right direction. It's a true call to action, a call for each of you to remain involved, to educate ourselves about our health, and ensure that the laws of this country are representing the needs of our families, our communities, our diverse backgrounds. And as advocates for public health, you know you have a lot more work to do, not only in our healthcare system, but every other aspect of our lives that touches our health. But we are slowly tackling these issues one at a time. The President and the Congress delivered on providing Americans quality, affordable healthcare coverage. They did for us what many before us weren't able to do. It's now our turn to do for our country by remaining involved, offering comments during the comment period, applying for grants, engaging in research, and allowing your voices to be heard, and of course, by having your votes counted. We have a long journey ahead of us, and I look forward to sharing that journey with each of you.
Thank you, Ms. Alvarez, for launching us into our topic. You've done a wonderful job in setting the stage, and you've given us an excellent foundation for our discussion to continue. During the health care reform debate, there were proposals for moving to a single-payer system, a Medicare for all, or for offering a public option. American Indians and Alaska Natives have a great deal of experience with a public option. Since tribes were promised health care in exchange for their land, we now turn to Mr. Ralph Fakara to tell us how well this particular public option has worked by giving us a context for thinking about health disparities and health care financing. Welcome, Mr. Fakara, and now I recognize you.
Thank you, Dr. Lee. I appreciate the opportunity to be here, and it's a real pleasure to be here in North Carolina. I was here about 20-some years ago and it's changed a little bit since I've been here, but it's a real pleasure to be back. As mentioned, my name is Ralph Forcara. I'm a member of the Juanino Band of California Mission Indians, which is a state-recognized tribe from the San Juan Capistrano area of Southern California. For those of you who don't know where San Juan Capistrano is, it's about 40 miles south of Disneyland. So I think everybody probably in this room and out in the audience out there knows where Disneyland is at. Well, we're right on the coast near in Southern California. I come to this after working in the field of health for probably 35 years now. In the last 29 years, I've been working exclusively in the area of urban Indian health. Urban Indian health is kind of a unique area, and I'll talk a little bit more throughout this presentation about urban Indian health as opposed to Indian health as in the broader sense, although I'll touch on that also. And then talk a little bit about some of my feelings about both the good things that have gone on with the healthcare reform legislation that I'm very excited about, but also some precautionary notes about as a person who's been going through the process of dealing with these issues for decades, some of the precautionary notes that I believe I can share with you about the importance of our diligently being involved, as Myra has mentioned. I think it's important to recognize the fact that we are starting the journey, not ending the journey. And hopefully we'll all of us in this room and all of those of you out in cyber world will be dedicated to working on these issues. I'm the executive director for the Seattle Indian Health Board. Just to tell you a little bit about that, Seattle Indian Health Board is celebrating its 40th anniversary this year. We were started as a free clinic 40 years ago and have evolved into becoming one of the largest urban Indian health programs in the country. And about 10 years ago, I started a thing called the Urban Indian Health Institute, which is a research and study center that we created primarily because people didn't know about urban Indians. They didn't realize the fact that there are a substantial number of Indian people that don't live on Indian reservations and instead live in major cities throughout the country. And they also didn't realize that these people were struggling with a variety of social and health problems associated with that. And so because that was unknown and we were having a difficult time arguing with folks about trying to get resources for our community, we decided that we would take on the challenge of trying to build a center that could focus attention around, specifically around the urban Indian health concerns in the country, and have over the years published a number of different publications to try to address that particular issue. And I'll talk a little bit more about that in a few minutes. As I mentioned, about two-thirds of the Indians, according to the 2000 census, were living in cities in the United States. When most people think of American Indians, they usually think of reservation Indians. They usually think of Indians living in rural areas. They usually think of Indian people living in fairly isolated areas. Or the other stereotype that is often connoted with Indian people is that they live in these communities with these giant casinos, and everybody is rich, and so therefore there's no need to take care of these people anymore. Well, the majority of casinos in the United States on Indian reservations really don't make a lot of money. And those that do make money oftentimes spend their money by pouring it back into their communities to build community centers, to build senior centers, to provide services that are unavailable, have been unavailable to Native people most of their existence. And so a lot of that resource does in fact go back into the communities as opposed to being being spent on a variety of other issues. Having money, though, does in fact create some problems. When you don't have money, you don't realize what you can get when you do have money. And when you do get money for the first time, it takes a while to learn how to use it appropriately. And so Indian people, like many societies that have gone through the struggles of going from poverty to wealth, have struggled through a variety of different, through that transition, and Indian people are no different. The transition from reservation to urban has been rather steady since 1970, as you can see. And it's a trend that we anticipate will continue. The world population, as many of you might know, became fully urban for the first time in history in about 2008. So people are moving to cities in droves primarily because of economics to a great degree. There are more job opportunities, more educational opportunities, more opportunities for people to acquire a reasonable life in a city than there are in the more rural areas of the country. And so not only in this country, but also throughout the world, more and more people are moving into major metropolitan areas. So the question that we're asked to talk about today is, what will health reform mean for minority health disparities, given the fact that the president did in fact sign the Patient Protection and Affordable Act and the Healthcare and Education and Reconciliation Act, which kind of brought together programs and services and expectations and promises that Myra did such an excellent job at outlining for us. I personally have not read all 2,500 pages of the health reform bill. I doubt if there's anybody in this room who's probably read all 2,500 pages. I know a few people that have read all 2,500 pages, I applaud them for doing so. But the most important thing from the Indian side of this was, as again Myra mentioned, was the fact that there's a law called the Indian Healthcare Improvement Act that was passed in 1976 that basically defines the parameters of healthcare for American Indians that the government owes to Indian people. That law sunset in 2001, and for the last 10 years we've been struggling to try to get it reauthorized, having a very, very difficult time working through the process of reauthorization. Surprisingly, and I think Senator Durbin was certainly involved in the process, but I know that Senator Baucus and Senator Thune from Montana were very involved in the process of making sure that the Indian Healthcare Improvement Act was part of the final bill. And then what really struck us as being remarkable was the fact that they didn't just extend the reauthorization, they made it a permanent law. And from the standpoint of the urban Indian side of the house, that was enormously significant, because the urban Indian piece of the program has always been a little bit tenuous. We've always gone through a variety of challenges to the fact that because we're not sovereign tribes, which is how the government generally tries to look at Indian people, that sometimes we're not eligible for certain kinds of benefits, including health care. And the fact that we were able to get that law permanent with a provision in there specifically for urban Indians gives us now a little bit more clout in terms of our capacity to be able to negotiate as a member of the Indian world. For those of you not familiar with the Indian Health Service is an agency of the Department of Health and Human Services. It was established in 1955 to administer the federal trust obligation for Indian health. And it uses three basic delivery systems for the health care that it provides. The Indian Health Service itself operates hospitals and clinics throughout the country that are staffed and operated directly by the government. In the last three decades, the Indian Health Program can be assumed by tribal communities through what are called contracts and compacts. A contract is kind of just a contract. It's an agreement to manage a scope of work. But a self-governance compact for tribal communities is a situation where the tribal community actually dictates how health care will be delivered in their community. So they have a lot more control over over the types of resources that they provide, and the type and manner in which they provide those services, and how they go about managing those services. So it gives the tribes and their local communities a lot more autonomy in the way that they manage and deliver health care. And then within the scope of the Indian Health Service is also a small program that directs resources to about 34 urban contracts around the country right now in 19 states that provide basic assistance to communities to try to help them gain better access to health care. Some of us have actually developed direct service programming, but a lot of the programs still offer more transitional services and case management assistance rather than direct services in their provision of care. As I mentioned, the Urban Indian Program is Title V of the program. Its scope is really access and not so much direct service. There are 34 programs in 19 states. We also serve a broader category of Indian person. Most of the Indian Health Service is focused on members of federally recognized Indian tribes, and mostly on reservation communities and those reservation and those areas right around reservation communities. The urban Indian programs, on the other hand, serve a much broader population of Indian people because during the 1950s and 1960s, there was actually a process, a policy in this country of what was called relocation and termination, where Indian people living in rural reservation areas were actually uprooted from their homes, moved into major cities throughout the United States, and then those tribes were legally terminated by acts of Congress. 109 Indian tribes and about 160,000 Indian people were affected by that. Those Indian people no longer had federal recognition, but they were still Indian people. And so the federal government recognized the fact that they were the culprits in placing these people in these circumstances in cities throughout the country. And as a result of that, had some obligation to assist them. And that's where the Title V program kind of evolved from. Here is where they're located. And as you can see, most of the programs are in the western part of the United States. However, we know that there are Indians in the southeast. In fact, I met yesterday with a group of people from North Carolina here who are interested in organizing an Indian health board to start looking at building capacity for serving Indian people that live in North Carolina. We've met with groups in Florida, we've met with groups in Texas, we've met with groups in a variety of places around the country that have sizable Indian populations that are just starting to organize themselves and we're trying to help them build capacity in order to be able to bring resources to their community. Myra mentioned that one of the advantages that we have right now is the fact that in the health care bill was approximately $11 billion that's been set aside for community health centers and for the National Health Service Corps, which means that there's going to be enormous opportunity for institutions like the North Carolina Indian Health Board to possibly go after some of those resources in order to start building capacity for themselves. And we're encouraging other institutions to do that, both from the standpoint of being able to get resources to build healthcare services for their communities, but also being a part of something that the Congress and the President believe is an answer to the healthcare crisis in this country, community health centers. Can't hurt you in the long run as far as your capacity to be able to maintain yourself over time, which is going to be one of the issues that I think we're all going to have to deal with. Unfortunately, the Urban Indian Health Program, even though we represent 67% of the population, get only 1% of the Indian Health Service budget. So it's not a lot of money that we have to work with, and that's why access tends to be the focus of our attention. And then those of us who provide direct care services often get our resources from programs other than the Indian Health Service. Indians that leave reservations, that are currently still members of reservations and leave reservations, are oftentimes affected by the fact that they move to a city. They oftentimes lose their assistance from the tribes that they get, so housing assistance, food assistance, other kinds of assistance, they lose access to that. They oftentimes lose their voting rights on reservations. Most reservations run a very democratic kind of a society, and so losing your voting rights is not something that you necessarily want to do. They may be actually removed from the tribal roles. Some of the tribes, because of economics, will sometimes lessen their roles because resources don't, if the denominator is smaller, then the number that actually can be distributed on a per capita basis is a little bit higher. And so there's game playing that goes on around that, and sometimes individuals who are off reservation get affected by that. And they may no longer be considered an Indian by either the federal government or tribes. This is something that we contend with a lot. The idea that Indian people that are off reservation and not recognized within that federal scope are sometimes placed in kind of an inferior standing within the Indian world. And those of us who work with urban Indians realize that we're really working with Indian people. We're not just working with Indian tribes. We're working with people who have a long and distinguished history of being a part of major cultures in this society for many, many generations. And we feel, anyway, that they should be recognized as such. The invisibility that we've had as urban Indian programs has led to some challenges for us. For example, as I mentioned earlier, the Justice Department has challenged our legitimacy on a couple of occasions. During both the Reagan administration and the Bush administration, there were attempts to do that. The Bush administration actually zeroed funding out for urban Indian health programs the last three budgets that the president submitted to the Congress. Fortunately, the Congress did not agree with that, and reverse that position. So will improved access to health care or medical care in the situation that we're talking about through insurance reform help close the health disparities gap for urban Indians? Health disparities is a much more complex issue than just health care. It really is an issue of social conditions, an issue of cultural differences, an issue of economics, certainly, and a lot of historical factors. Among American Indians, historical factors play an enormous role. The experience for the Indian Health Service is that even though the Indian community possesses a federal trust obligation from the federal government, we have a long history with government making us promises of benefits, but then not following through on those promises. So most of us that work in Indian affairs tend to be a little bit cautionary about the way that we deal with promises that are made not only to us directly, but also promises that might be made through the health reform legislation. Although I don't want to dismiss the enormity of what the President and the Congress have accomplished by passing health reform legislation. The IHS claims that they're funded at about 50% of need. However, that doesn't take into consideration the urban Indian need that might be out there, which is probably at least twice or three times that. As I mentioned, some of us are community health centers also, so we are encouraging a lot of our programs to become community health centers because of the resource base that that brings to you, as well as the political clout that that might help us with in the long run. There were some very positive steps towards reform. Of course, the elimination of pre-existing conditions is going to have an enormous effect, especially on Native communities where a very, very large subset of the Native population experience health experience disparities. 26%, according to the studies, indicate that Indian people have some physical or mental disability that has, in fact, interfered with their capacity to be able to be insured. So just that in and of itself will be very valuable. Of course, the parental insurance for children. Small business tax credit is going to be a very interesting one because a recent study came out that indicated that a lot of small businesses, even in spite of the tax credit, really still can't afford insurance. So until insurance rates start to come down, and that's when the exchanges start to kick in, that's when I think we may see some improvement in the small businesses. And then the rebate for Medicare, I think, is another very valuable and important aspect. But another finding for Indian people is the fact that we found that on the Navajo reservation, for example, the majority of Navajo elders who have lived subsistence living out raising sheep and working out in the rural areas there are not eligible for Medicare because they never paid enough of their Medicare cycles in, so they're not going to be eligible for that. We found a similar kinds of situation for Alaska Natives who live in rural villages and have lived mostly a subsistence lifestyle. So Medicare improvements may not be helpful. So I'm going to go through these really fast here. Some of the challenges that I think and some of the things that are that we're concerned about is the fact that economics and sustainability of the healthcare reform piece is going to be something that we're going to have to all be very cognizant of. If you notice in the paper right now or on television, there's not much talk about healthcare. It's all the Gulf, the problem in the Gulf. It's all the war in Iraq. It's all the floundering economy and the ups and downs of the stock market. Healthcare has kind of fallen off the radar screen, and that's a concern that all of us need to be wary of, that we need to make sure that we keep health care visible, because if we don't, it's going to be very easy for it to be overlooked. Some of the challenges to health care, the magnitude of the change. We're talking about a sea level change in the way that we have to, of what we need to do. The sustainability of change, even if we can make incremental change, can we sustain it over time? The need for more resources. Short term, we're going to have to make investments of enormous amounts of resources before we're going to be able to make changes. And then the primary care crisis that we have in this country, where we're going to have to shift the dynamics away from specialists and to a primary care, more of a primary care position. The solutions I've talked about a little bit already. The healthcare reform agenda was an important change for us. As a person who's worked in this field for the last 35 years, having seen this in my lifetime is an enormous accomplishment, but the work has just begun, not only for the American Indian community, but for all communities. And when I mean all communities, I mean the entire United States of America, because the changes have to occur across the entire system. And so I look forward to working with Myra. I look forward to working with all of the people in this room over the years to come. And I think that there's a great opportunity for us, and let's take advantage of that. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Mr. Ficarra, for placing health care financing in the broader context of health disparities, particularly in respect to the original Americans, and for telling us about creative initiatives that can make a difference as we move forward. Now, to examine the context in which health care reform will play out, especially among urban African Americans, Professor Whitehead will tell us about the impact of the new law on the problems of racialized urban ghettos and what can be learned from community-based participatory research. Dr. Whitehead has been here for many years in North Carolina, a graduate of Shaw University. Dr. Whitehead, we extend a warm welcome to you back home and recognize you at this time.
Thank you, and good afternoon to everyone. I guess I'm taking a sort of different approach, being an academician and a researcher. My point is that this whole healthcare reform will need participation from so many of us. And what do we do here in the academy? Even with sort of little-known disciplines as my own, anthropology, there is a role that we can play. I was a faculty member here in the School of Public Health back in the late 70s, early 80s, and I was taught a lot. In fact, when I arrived here, I suffered culture shock. And after 2 years, I said to my chair, I don't know what the hell it is that you people in health education do. I had come from a Department of Anthropology, new PhD, very theoretical, and I just didn't understand this stuff. So he looked at me, Dr. Guy Stewart, and he said, what the hell is it that you anthropologists do? And I wasn't prepared to answer the question. I didn't know what we were supposed to be doing. But I said, you know, we go into situations that we don't know very well, and it seems like chaos, but we know that there is a system there, and our job is to come to understand that. And he said, well, get the hell out of my office and go do your job. There were so many lessons that I learned, and one of them, the importance of public health. First of all, reaching out to those at greatest risk, underserved, those in great need, and those who are hard to reach. The other lesson that I think was central was that my role as a health educator or even an anthropologist was to be a broker of how do you bring the resources to those in need. And I want to take a few minutes. I got to get through this stuff. But all too often when we start something new or there's something new that passed, that goes, that we forget that there are people before us who are doing these things. And I want to take this time to recognize some of those people. One was Guy Stewart, as I mentioned, who was always giving me lessons. We used to fight all the time. There was a Mr. Howard Bonhill here who actually started a war on poverty in North Carolina before it was adopted in Washington. There was Mr. Leonard Dawson, a good old boy from Kentucky, who said to me one day, said, Tone, I never would think that my two best friends would be the two black faculty members in the department. And one of the reasons for that, although Leonard didn't have a PhD, he took mercy on me, and when I was frustrated, he would go in with a cigarette hanging out and say, all that crap you are talking about, Tony, this is what it means. Margaret Pollard, was one who really contributed. And these first four people, they are all passed. That's why I'm mentioning them. Margaret Pollitt passed recently. She was the first person to get me involved in Johnston County and really taught me what it was to go out to a county where people need what you're doing and they wanted the message, et cetera. People who are still living, Ms. Polly Lambert, who is here in the audience, is from Johnston County. For the 11 years I was here, she made sure that my students and I stayed on message about Johnston County, North Carolina. And of course, John Hatch. I consider John Hatch to be a genius in working in communities. I mean, all I had to do is to go out with him, to see him do what he did in Silas City in transforming some change in Chatham County to me with $15,000. And that was a very good lesson because a lot of the things that I do, I don't have very much money. I'm not a big funded person, just small monies. But the thing about that was very important about lessons is that you come to understand the importance of policies, but policies without action plans are just sort of tools that people give you. It was like when I first got married and I thought I was going to do the man building stuff. You know, I was going to make things, so I bought all of these tools. And I never built anything because I didn't have the motivation or the will, and I didn't have an action plan. So the issue is, now, what do we do with these things? Now, some of these things that I'm going to bring up, I think that we all know, bills that and policies that brought the attention of health disparities to us. But here again, we usually talk about these bills, and we talk about them in terms of these large macro types of differences, you know, how we compare people of color with whites. However, it's within these categories that we do find people who are in great need, what Wilson called the underclass, who are really at the heart of disparities, but are frequently left out for a lot of reasons. So how do we reach those particular populations? As Ralph pointed out, with urban Indians and being invisible. So we have to move beyond that. And so that's where one of these groups for myself, it's a group that I began to refer to as racialized urban ghettos. We usually refer to these populations as such because they are usually referred to as sort of underserved, inner city, et cetera. But I intentionally began to use this concept of racialized for several reasons. One is that in the communities that I work in the Baltimore-Washington urban corridor, most of the communities are 90% black or more. There was a book published in 94 called American Apartheid that talked about this type of segregation that exists in our city. Also, by using the title of racialization, I wanted to really speak to the fact that we also have to address race and racism, both in terms of the policies that created, contributed to these communities, as well as the role that race and racism play in the heads of the people who reside in these particular populations. All of those things have to be addressed if we are going to address the issues that we are talking about with reform. They have high population density. One lady in Baltimore said to me, "No wonder we are killing ourselves." When I showed her some maps about where people live and density, we're all living on top of each other. Low male to female population ratios, particularly in this age group, as homicide became a leading killer of young blacks, and also what I refer to as the incarceration epidemic, began to remove these young men from these communities. This results in high female-headed households, single females, and the only problem with that, well, there are many problems, is that they don't earn as much money, so there's a sort of a feminization of poverty. Inadequate employment opportunities. all the rest of the stuff related to employment, the exodus of high socioeconomic status residents, resulting in a lower tax base, high rates of concentrated and extreme poverty, difficulties in trying to take advantage of employment opportunities elsewhere, highest mortality rates from many of these conditions, continual environmental deterioration, high levels of social and cultural isolation, I'm not going to go into the definition of these words, recent in-migration of other groups with competition over scarce resources, what some people call gentrification, others call revitalization, but the displacement of people from their communities, from their houses, but also from their homes. Home has a really powerful meaning for people. And of course, the stuff that I've been into for the last few years that has to do with incarceration and the increased rates now of prison to community reentry, where you take young people out of the community, you make prison their primary socializing institution. Also in prison where you learn to become a criminal for some people who weren't criminals before, you get all sorts of conditions and diseases, then you're turned back into the community without opportunity, and these communities are already struggling with a lot of issues. So one of the things in the work that I do, everything that I talk about, I'm reminded of by the people that I work with doing focus groups. People talked about their own communities as being unhealthy because of all of these particular issues. They also talk about we all have to be accountable. We all have to respond. The parents, the schools, the neighborhoods, and particularly, what are you people in the university going to do? You can do a lot as well. And then they suggest we all have to work together. There has to be an intersectorial type of approach to this. So we need multiple tools because of this complexity. And so another particular initiative back in 2000 that started was community-based participatory research. And I look at community-based participatory research as being very important because it began to give federal attention to for people like myself who have been talking about this community-based approach, and we need to be involved, and academicians need to be involved. And so CBPR called on academicians to work with people in communities, and they call on this in a federal policy. Health disparities, that we all know what that is. CBPR is not only a tool, but it's also an action plan. And it's an action plan that's given to you generally, and you have to sort of organize it based on your own particularly community setting. And these are just some items to support that particular position. So the relevance for these communities that are underserved, I think Myra brought up these particular points, so this is something that I can skip in terms of components of the bill itself. What else can be done? Now, community-based participatory research has been adopted in several universities all over the country. People are making attempts to bring universities into play in working with their communities. I think that public health, like at North Carolina, has been at the forefront of this for years. I was recently reminded that community-based participatory research hasn't been working in ways in many places that people had hoped for. But like any other policy, everything has to be worked on. It can be improved. And part of our job is to continue to work to improve this approach, as well as come up with new ideas in terms of how we can do this intersectoral type of thing that people in the community call for. Okay, so what I've done, although I hope to retire soon, is that I just created a five-year strategic plan to sort of bring together the development of science around what I do in ethnography and what I've done for years in terms of community health research as science. And so the first activity that we propose is really stuff that I've been working on for a long time. How to bring your outreach from the university to communities into a sort of a plan that is systemic, that really, really you lay out and you try to train your students, you try to develop action plans, you have partnerships with the community, et cetera. Now, I wanted to just say this stuff here isn't important. I just put it down because sometimes people will say, well, you aren't proposing anything that's new, or where is the public health, or where are the other theories, et cetera. They are there. That's all that this is about. But part of my thing was that in my long career of working in public health, there were these areas that didn't seem to be connected. You know, people would talk about, well, do a needs assessment, but sometimes the needs assessment wasn't attached to the program that was being designed or how the program was being evaluated, et cetera. So these are just four systems that I've developed that's part of this thing. And you can either go to the CUSAG website or you can see this thing later for more information. I only have 20 minutes here, and sometimes I get off into stories. Another one that we propose is also what we've been doing is an urban health and human ecology project. And that comes completely out of public health and what I learned here. It's really collecting data at the neighborhood level that focuses on the needs within these communities. And the second big category, what are the assets and resources? And so part of our orientation, again, that came out of North Carolina, is that we sort of began to collect this data and the data that we have collected to organize it, put it into this system, continue to update it with our students, and to be able to feed it back to those communities from which we collected so that they can use the data to design their own programs. Because for a lot of the activities that community-based organizations attempt, when they go for funding, they will talk about these issues, but frequently they will be asked by the funder, well, where is the data? We need more than your stating this particular issue. Another area of very important, that's very important, is that of evaluation. It's becoming more and more important, and so we have more organizations now that we have thrown ourselves out there in the DC area saying we need evaluation. We can't get funded without evaluation. Can you help us with evaluation? Well, if you don't systemically put something together, I can't do all of this by myself. You got to be able to integrate. And within the university, you have a lot of resources and skills. And in the training of your students, hopefully, you can address that. So the other thing is that can we really, really sort of institutionalize this university to community health outreach? I wanted to, and I need to close this down soon, a question that was put to me by one of my focus groups that was very, very contentious. They came in cussing me out, cussing out the University of Maryland. And, you know, they were saying, look, we've been telling these people this stuff about reentry and prisons and all of this for 20 years, the folk in this city. They don't listen. They just do the same old crap. They give some money to an academic at the University of Maryland to come out here and ask us these same stupid questions. And one person, they made the point, what we want to know, are you here to help us, harm us, or do nothing? And they go into this thing about a lot of you people, academicians and journalists, you come out here, you get your thesis, you write your papers, and then you write up all of this stuff about our pathologies. But what have you done to really, really help with the issue? So I'm going to cut through some of this because I know I'm coming to the end. I mentioned before people references to their own communities. There are calls for more university-based accountability, and that was the reason for this idea of the UC Hon. We've had a number of workshops that I sort of put together to first recognize the people on campus who were that were working around these particular issues of particularly of prison to community reentry. And so we did a workshop and we got all those people together, and then the next year we sort of invited in policymakers, community-based organization representatives, and others. And so now what we plan to do, hopefully, is in January to have a longer conference in which we are bringing people out to have discussions, presentations. We did this some years ago with AIDS and African Americans. And in fact, Ms. Lambert, who was from Johnson County, was now up as an administrative assistant for a congressman from Johnson County, and she helped me pull that off. And this is, again, the thing about money and my saying not having much money, it's always related to the people. Who would ever know that the lady from Johnson County who helped me there would now be helping me in Capitol, you know, on the Hill. So this is the stuff with regards to what we plan to do that I just spoke to. Because what is happening with all of this stuff, like this removal of young men from these communities, when you have young men being removed, then you have difficulty in terms of developing strong, healthy families because you reduce the pool of potential husbands and fathers. And without strong families, how do you begin the process of having healthy communities? So all the stuff becomes related. So what we did with the AIDS conference that we did some years ago, we had a lot of panel discussions, and we spent 3 days on this topic, and people felt that they didn't have enough time, that they were just getting into the issues that they need to address. So I'm almost at the end. These are some things that we plan to offer at the workshop that's related to part of the conference, that it's related to some of the skills that we want to transfer and to provide technical assistance. And then, of course, being from a small department of anthropology without too much money, we are in a process of really getting the School of Public Health to be one of our primary partners. We have a new School of Public Health that's only 4 years old, but they are really doing some very interesting things in those 4 years. One is that they started a partnership some years ago with a community there in which they were carrying out some of these activities, and I was on their advisory committee for about 3 or 4 years. Last year they got their Prevention Research Center funded. They have this new Center for Health Equity that I'm going to come back in a minute. They have started this global health activity, and they've started a project of working with churches in a sort of a community-based participatory research approach. And they also are trying to address this issue of health literacy, that all of the issues around literacy generally, and then people's knowledge, lack of knowledge about health care, the health care system, et cetera. The area of cultural competency. I try to convince my colleagues in anthropology that this is really a place that anthropologists can play quite a role to understand cultural differences. I remember a few years ago, I was working with the guy who was the director of the AIDS program in DC. And he said to me, he said, look, we need more of you folk because D.C. now has such cultural diversity that we can't begin to even think about developing successful programs unless we have some knowledge of the culture, language, and all the rest of this stuff. So please ask your colleagues with this expertise to help us in understanding some of this. And then they also are working on HIV/AIDS. This is just some stuff of my relationship with them. That's not really that important. School of Public Health. I'm excited about the possibility of working with the Center for Health Equity because the university has just brought five people in from the University of Pittsburgh to man this thing, a whole team. And I've known these folk for a long time. And we do have similar approaches to our community health orientation. So I look at them, I welcome them, and hopefully that even some of the goals that I have from where I sit can be achieved. This thing is not a long info commercial for the work at Maryland and CUSAC. I try to use it as an example of how we in the university, again, taking the lessons that I learned at UNC, and how we can play a role in actually achieving the goals and objectives related to healthcare reform. And that is the only way that, that these things will really have the impact that they could have.
Well, thank you very much, Dr. Whitehead, for sharing the findings from your research and offering a vision of what schools of public health, social work, and other engaged academic organizations can do. That not only is very inspirational, but certainly insightful. As we synthesize the presentations and you reflect on all that has been made, all of our presenters and who have made all the brief observations, we now move to the question and discussion portion of our program. Let me urge you once again to please send your questions or comments to questions@unc.edu or to use the web form and via web form at www.minority.unc.edu/question. Or you can call, and your calls will be piped in here to the auditorium at 1-877-869-7811. Now, for those of you who are here in the auditorium, please use one of the microphones in the aisles. But we suggest you write out your question and your comment so you can ask it clearly and concisely. So we now pause for 5 minutes to set up the stage for our panel, and we'll be right back. Welcome back for the discussion portion of our program. This is the opportunity for you to jump in and engage in conversation with our panelists. If you have questions or comments, please come to the microphones if you're in the auditorium set up in the aisles. And I ask as you come to the microphones that you state your name prior to posing your question or making your comment. Those of you viewing via the internet, you may call in by using the number 1-877-869-7811, and others of you may send an email to question@unc.edu, or you may submit via the web form at www.minority.unc.edu/question. I once again urge you to please write out your questions so you can state it concisely, and so that we may have an opportunity to get as many create as many opportunities for people to participate as possible. At this time, we have a question coming in via email, and I recognize Ms. Brooks to state the question.
Our first question comes from Pam Winton, and that's from the Frank Porter Graham Child Development Institute here in Chapel Hill. The question is, does the Affordable Health Care Act have any provisions for home visiting programs with families of young children at risk, including those with disabilities?
We
want to take that first? Ms. Alvarez?
I'll take that. yes, the Affordable Care Act does include a grant program specifically for home visiting programs. It's actually $1.5 billion over 5 years dedicated to specifically home visiting programs, such as the Nurse Family Partnership, a very successful program throughout the country that takes nurses into homes, has home visits, and is able to actually reduce many health disparities in communities throughout the country.
I think we'll go to a microphone question. If you'll state your name, please, and pose your question.
Hello, I'm Diane Raleigh. I'm in the Department of Maternal and Child Health here at the Gilling School of Public Health. And my question concerns providing care to women of reproductive age. Up until the passage of the Health Reform Act, over 40% of women who delivered a baby here in North Carolina only received insurance after they got pregnant through Medicaid, and then for the 6 weeks postpartum. Yet they had many needs after those 6 weeks, and recent studies have shown that preventive care during the preconception period and interconception period is very important for improving the outcomes of babies and the mothers. So in designing healthcare reform, was there any thought given to how to create a seamless program for women from really from birth until 65, which turns out to be most of the reproductive age now?
Ms. Alvarez, I think that's a natural for you.
Sure. That's actually a really good point. One of the things, before the passage of the Affordable Care Act, the Medicaid program eligibility was based on categorically eligible. So you had to have been a pregnant woman or, for some states, really, really below poverty, disabled. So certain categories were eligible for Medicaid. After passage of this bill, we now believe everyone under 133% of poverty will qualify for Medicaid, regardless if you fit into a specific category or not. That's the type of safety net that you're looking for. So a young woman who's pregnant will have care the 6 weeks after she delivers her baby and for the rest of her life if she remains in under that level of poverty. Or even if she's not pregnant, if a young woman is living below 133% of poverty, or a young man for that matter, for the first time in American history, a young man can also qualify for Medicaid starting in 2014. They'll be able to have that safety net and that security.
I want to check to make sure that our male panelists don't have any insights they'd like to share with us on this question.
In Washington State, we've had a program of maternal and child health program to deal with early pregnancy initiatives for at least the 20 years that I've been working up in that area. It's had a remarkably successful program because it does make an easy transition between prenatal care and getting women in to prenatal services early on in their pregnancy, right through their delivery. And in some of the community health centers actually in Washington State actually still do labor and delivery themselves. And so we're actually able to follow the woman not only before treatment, not only before delivery, but also through delivery and then aftercare for the 6 weeks or so after that. But most of the women then do in fact get enrolled into the Medicaid program or some other program. And especially their children get enrolled in things like WIC, the Women's Infant and Children's Program, and other programs using the community health center model, which has a much more comprehensive kind of an approach to the way that we go about looking at these things. We can actually build a continuum for women and their children to get them a more stabilized kind of an environment in order to be able to get that care. I'm really proud to say that in Seattle, at the Seattle Indian Health Board, we looked at infant birth weight for the children that we delivered, and over a six-year period of time, every single child that was delivered by our providers was at normal birth weight when they were delivered, which I think is quite a remarkable accomplishment. But not only that, it really demonstrates that these programs, if you can build the continuums effectively, can in fact have a profound effect on improvements in the health of both the mother and the child.
Dr. Whitehead, anything to add?
No, I don't have to.
We have a caller. Caller, would you please state your name and the location from where you're calling, and then pose your question. Caller, are you there?
Hi, yes.
My name is Siobhan Todatini, and from the name, I'm sure you can tell that I come from the Navajo Nation. And this question is for, Ralph Forquera. You did use the example of the traditional Navajo elders who live out in, you know, isolated Navajo country. I do have parents who are elders at this point, and I'm just worried about them not becoming eligible for Medicare because they do have quite a lot of health issues. So what do you foresee in their situation?
If they're currently getting their, that's a great question, because if they're currently getting their care from the Indian Health Service, I don't anticipate at this point in time that they really will have a difficulty continuing to get care through that particular system. However, if they need services that would require them to go outside of the Indian Health System, then having access to Medicare services would certainly ease their capacity to be able to get care at non-Indian Health Service facilities. The fact that there are a number of individuals, not just in the Native community, but also throughout the nation, who were finding pockets of people who didn't pay in enough through their lives to qualify for Medicare, I think is an issue that the nation's going to need to address at some point in time. I think the fact that it was brought up in the Native community allows us to begin conversations about how are we going to address that problem over time. And in hope that we can come to some solution to deal not only with the Native population, but I'm sure that there are even poor whites in the Appalachian country, in Appalachian areas, that have similar kinds of problems, as well as urban whites that are and urban communities in general, where people just have not worked enough quarters to qualify for these programs. And so we're going to have to look at eligibility around some of those issues. And I think the healthcare reform debate that went on allowed us to, in some respects, to ask some of these really, really interesting questions that we probably wouldn't have asked had we not gone through this process. But by identifying this as being a problem, my hope is that we can find some reasonable solutions. And I'm sure that working with Senator Durbin's staff and other staff, now that that's recognized, I think we can come to some reasonable solutions to that.
It's these types of questions, I think, that are so important, because they get us thinking toward developing a laundry list of those things that we need to work on in order to move the bill forward and try to hopefully someday reach a level, high level of perfection.
Yeah, I think it also brings up the fact that the healthcare problem is much more extensive than just the healthcare system itself. It is a lot of these questions about historical programs that have been created around categorical or some other kinds of means testing in order to qualify for these programs, which at the time made a lot of sense.
Right.
But in the 21st century, might be things that need to be reevaluated.
We do have a question on my left mic here. And if you'd state your name and pose your question.
Sorry, this is tough. Hello, greetings. My name is Ayanna Cash Clements. I'm a participant of the UNC Public Health Summer Fellowship Program. And I know you discussed some obstacles and challenges of inadequate funding and also about the Indian community being invisible. Like, for example, I know there's an issue of Indian urban women that have reproductive health due to sexual violence, which is highly overlooked. So do you find, from your experience with the Indian community, do they have some concern with the implementation of this new permanent Indian Act? And also, will it expedite their access to care, and if they truly accept and trust this new health care reform bill due to past experiences?
A lot of questions. I'm glad you brought up the issue of women's reproductive health. We just completed a study, actually, through the Urban Indian Health Institute that I direct, just published a paper on looking at the family growth, I can't remember the database, but one of the things that fell out of the database was the fact that there's a very, very high incidence of sexual violence against young Indian women in cities. This was actually mentioned by President Obama himself at a meeting that he had with the tribes in November of last year, but he was relating it to the tribal communities and a lot of the isolated tribal communities. And we found a similar finding for Indian women living in cities, which would indicate that this seems to be a problem that I don't think is unique to just the Native community. I think it's an issue, a tragic issue that the nation needs to deal with. As far as, I don't think it's specifically defined in any of the reform bills, nor is it specifically defined in the Indian Health Care Improvement Act. But the fact that we now have a permanent authority gives us, I think, the capacity to be able to bring some of these issues to light. I know that when I testified earlier this year before the House Interior Appropriations Committee, I mentioned this issue to them in hopes that they might direct some resources for us to quantify the problem even more and find it and start and begin to start trying to understand what are the variables that might be affecting this so that we can design programs to try to address it. But we're really in the earliest stages of those kinds of conversations, and the specifics of how we will be able to use that legislation I think is still up in the air in terms of what we can do. But the permanency of it, I don't want to understate, the permanency of it gives us a great deal of authority, I believe, to bring some of these really difficult issues for a society to deal with, a group to deal with like Native Americans. And my hope is that by us dealing with these problems and struggling with these problems, what we learn from that can be extended out to the broader communities. Because dealing with sexual violence or dealing with mental health issues or dealing with some of these things are extremely difficult problems and very, very emotionally driven problems that we're going to have to be very careful about how we do our study work around and especially how we respond to them. So it's still, I think, too early to tell if either of these pieces of legislation will have some impact on it, but I'm very hopeful that they will.
Ms. Alvarez, did you want to add something?
Yeah, just one small thing. Not only for Native American women, but for all women across the country, I think it's important to note that before passage of this law, it was actually legal in some states to have domestic violence victims be listed as a pre-existing condition on your insurance policy. You could be denied insurance because you were a victim of domestic violence. That is unbelievable, and this law stops that practice. So I think it's important that we're trying to make a benefit possible, not only for Native American women, but for women across the country.
Dr. Whitehead, anything to add?
Not that much. One of the things, though, that I was thinking about, sometimes as a researcher, trying to get at these issues, as you pointed out, is so difficult. It's made difficult by issues like we were doing some work with adolescent females, and there are all of this stuff that was coming out. But the whole issue of human subjects review, ethics, the legal issues of first getting at the information, and once you get it, what can you do with it? Because you aren't supposed to have people revealing names, even if they are the victims of you know, people committing these atrocities against them. So it's a very, very, very difficult issue to even find who the victims are and then move towards some action to address it. Hopefully the health care reform bill will help in terms of, as Ralph said, to have us thinking about some of these issues and bring them to the forefront. I wanted to just make one point that he was speaking to earlier about people who hadn't been working, hadn't been contributing into Medicare, Social Security, and all of this stuff. There are so many folk, even my own mother, who had been domestics all their lives, or people who worked in rural areas who had been sharecroppers and all of the rest of that, and they weren't paying into the system. And I think that we have quite a few now with people who are immigrants into the community. So I think Ralph's point about how the bill will bring us to begin discussing some of these issues with populations that have been left out is hopefully this bill will be an impetus for this.
Before we go to the next mic question, we have an email question. Ms. Brooks, would you like to state the question?
Yes, our question is from Pamela in Columbia, Missouri. And her question is, do you think healthcare reform will improve data collection of minorities in healthcare institutions?
Mrs. Alvarez or Dr. Whitehead?
It specifically includes a provision that will require federal health programs to collect specific information on race, ethnicity, poverty status, a number of different provisions. And actually, I think that's, I talked about it a little bit. The idea that we're trying to create programs that will impact health disparities in the future will be better targeted and more effective if we have accurate data to reflect what our communities actually look like.
Yes, I think that this is going to be very important because part of my orientation has to do with people who have been considered hidden populations, folk that you don't get to, you don't know that they are out there, et cetera. And these are really urgent public health problems that you have folk who aren't being even recognized, or we don't even know that they are there. They aren't ending up in some of the larger statistical categories. So part of my issue about some of the things that we wanted to do at the neighborhood level is to get beyond the census tract, the census block groups, et cetera, and really understand what's going on and trying to create databases. So hopefully we can make a contribution in terms of our research with regards to those issues.
Okay, we have a phone call, but I'm going to go to the right mic first, and then we'll take the caller.
Thank you. My name is Cynthia Baker, and the question is, do either of you have a vision for how underserved minority communities in all their diversity can collaborate, leveraging resources, even if limited, to eliminate health disparities among minority groups?
Come back to you.
yeah, this is a real challenge, and I say that from the whole position of community organizing, and part of what we continue to work with, for example, in some DC communities, let's say like Ward 1 in D.C., which is a very ethnically diverse. But even without the ethnic diversity, you have so many groups that are trying to respond to these issues. And all of these groups, because they are confronted with all of the issues in their communities, they try to do too much. And as we identify groups, the challenge then becomes, how do you get these folk to work together, to actually complement each other? And I think that a lot of these things will serve as impetus to help us work harder to come up with ideas. So I can't say, I do have some ideas about how to do this, but it really takes some intensive work on the parts of a lot of people. And even when I was suggesting trying to bring this conference together, part of what we want to do is to get people talking to each other, to come to the recognition that, hey, we are trying to do some of the same things, to understand that if you work together, it doesn't mean that then you are letting a competitor into the small amount of funding that you may get, et cetera. But how do you bring all of this energy, all of these ideas from the community itself? Because the solution to a lot of these issues at the community level, they rest with the community. And so that is so basic to some sort of organizing approach in terms of getting people within these communities that are addressing all of these issues to sort of begin talking to each other and developing visions that are their visions. I always say to people that there is nothing really mystical about what I do. I sort of take what they tell me and try to create some formula and an action plan for how they can move forward.
Anything to add, Mr. Ficarra?
I think partnerships and collaborations are extremely difficult to maintain over time. I think that there's a lot of well-meaning people who want to work together, and I think sometimes finance gets in the way, money gets in the way. But one of the things that I'm hoping we can do is change the dynamic a little bit. oftentimes resources go to major institutions. I don't mean to belittle the fact that you know the universities are out there, but communities can in fact manage grants. They can in fact operate nonprofit organizations effectively. They can in fact drive initiatives from the community level in a way that that the people themselves feel vested in making change, and as a result of that, the potential for its sustainability is much greater because you can spread that enthusiasm and excitement among many as opposed to few. And I think that somehow we need to look at how we approach communities and how we recognize communities for their true capacity to be able to solve problems. I think that's where the Indian Health Service, again, and especially the tribal communities, have in fact been leaders as tribal governments have begun to assume federal responsibilities for certain types of services. It took them a while to get there, but now they're at the point where they're really operating very efficient, very effective organizations and programs in their communities. I think that that's true of all of our communities. I think there are people in all of our communities who need to be given the opportunity to really show leadership, really show capacity to manage, really show that they can, in fact, solve problems at their community level. And I think it's up to government, it's up to major institutions like universities to say, okay, we want to work with this community. You, community, have the resources. You drive the agenda. You tell us what you want to do and how you want it done, and be willing to do that. Now, it's difficult for major institutions to do that, but hopefully over time we can change that dynamic.
Well, I think many universities are getting there because they're coming to realize that they basically should be enablers, and they recognize the best outcomes now are not outcomes that emanate from within the university, but through partnerships between the university and the community. So I've been very pleased to see progress being made along those lines, but that's an excellent point, Mr. Fakar, and I'm very pleased that you made that. Ms. Alvarez?
Just really quickly, I don't think many of the provisions in the new law would have been possible had it not been for the collaborative effort of many of the groups of color that came and spoke on behalf of these issues. It was Native American communities, African American communities, Latino communities, API groups that all joined together to form a comprehensive ask for what the health disparities provision should look like. Had it been each group coming in, speaking to every office individually, asking for the sun and the moon, they might not have gotten anything. So I think that collaboration is what makes it possible. Groups like the Racial and Ethnic Health Disparities Coalition, groups like Out of Many One, these are groups that represent the interests of all of us together and make the voice much more powerful because of that.
Excellent point. Caller, thank you for holding. Yeah. Please state your name and from where you're calling and your question.
My name is Dale, and I'm in St. Petersburg, Florida. I work for a local health department. And my question is, many folks that have insurance can't afford dental or mental health services. And as well, some of the Eastern medicine practices actually work better than pills. So does this new Reform Act, does it encompass oral health, mental health, and some of the Eastern modalities?
Ms. Alvarez?
So I think that's an excellent question and an excellent point. We know far too well that without good oral health care, you can end up in tragedies such as Diamante Driver, who passed away in Maryland at the age of, I think, 9 years old because of an abscess that led to his brain. I mean, that should never happen anywhere in our country. So I think what the new law does is present a basic package of health care services that every American should be entitled to. From there, it moves up the ladder as far as how comprehensive your plan could be. And that's going to be determined based on how much you're going to be spending on your health care coverage. But there is going to be a basic package of services that will include both mental health and dental coverage in order to make sure that you're living as healthy of life as you need to.
Thank you very much. And the Eastern modalities, do you think those will eventually be included?
I'm sorry?
The Eastern modalities, such as acupuncture, massage.
Integrative medicine? I think yes. So. I mean, they're advocating on behalf of their priorities as well. And I think it's more of an issue of awareness so that more members of Congress and legislative officials can actually know what type of health care services are available around our communities.
Okay. Thank you very much.
Thank you, caller. That's a wonderful question. Now we'll go to left mic.
Hello. My name is Enrique Marino. I'm participating with the School of Public Health Seminar Fellowship Program. I think we all know that the importance of this act in closing the disparity, but I feel that it might be inadequate, and by that I mean because I come from a low-income community where the right information sometimes is hard to filter through. So my question to Mr. Whitehead is, what is being done in terms of outreach efforts on the ground to help these people figure out where to find the right information or where to go?
That I mentioned the Center for Health Literacy, for example, the various outreach programs that from where I sit in the university that I feel very good about where universities are trying to move with regards to understanding this range of issues that we have. And as I was saying in my talk, I think that sure, we have some setbacks. I think that, you know, the whole issue about outreach, particularly from the university, is sort of like first convincing people in the university to really make a contribution. And there is a contribution. I agree with Ralph that the solution rests with the community itself. But there is the issue of, you know, having particular skills that you have been trained to do that's related to outreach, and as I mentioned, community organizing. And also just bringing those skills. I always say to people that, you know, I have certain skills. If you can use them, great. If you decide you don't want to use them, that's fine because I'll find other things to do. So I think that there are some real efforts now, as the senator said earlier. But everything is a challenge. You know, as someone said in the 60s with desegregation, some people thought, well, the battle is over now around issues dealing with race and discrimination. The challenge goes on. And I always say to people, the reason that I've stayed in the university is because I know some of my own interest in outreach, et cetera. It's not going to change things in my lifetime. But if I can have an impact on two or three students every year, and then they can have impacts on others, because the challenge is ongoing, and the only thing that we can do is to keep our eye on the prize, stay focused, and continue to work on it, and not to be dissuaded when we have setbacks, et cetera, because the challenge will always be there. There will always be some issues, and we want to make improvements. So I think people are making a real effort to do the outreach type of thing in many different directions. But it takes time.
I'd like to comment about that, too, because I think that outreach and community-based services are a part of the healthcare reform solution. I don't think we can afford to continue to care for people in institutions, clinics, hospitals, those kinds of places, is just too expensive. There are ways and evolving ways of being able to care for people in communities through the use of technology, through a variety of other outreach kinds of activities, much more emphasis on health education and teaching the community, not just a few individuals, but actually using churches, using schools, using institutions where people gather together in large groups, and giving them basic skills about how to do take care of themselves in the home, how to assess a basic health problem. You know, oftentimes people will take their child to an emergency room because they have a fever. You know, sometimes that fever, is dangerous, but sometimes it's just a fever. And children. I remember my kids. I mean, every other week they had a fever of one type or another. But, you know, understanding when is this something that really needs medical care, and when is this something that we can take care of in the home, and feeling comfortable with that, I think are educational. They're teachable things, and I think that we need to start looking at how do we bring those things to the community as a way of lessening the burden of having the need to use healthcare services on a consistent basis. And I think the only way we're going to solve the cost problem for healthcare is to use that kind of an approach. So that's why, again, I think North Carolina is such a great school, is because they do emphasize health education. They do emphasize community organization as a big piece of their public health agenda here, where a lot of other institutions seem to focus away from those particular areas. And I'm hoping that more schools of public health start incorporating more of that into their curricula.
Ms. Alvarez, did you add anything?
I definitely think, I strongly agree with both my fellow panelists as far as, I think the most trusted source of information is your community members, whether it's your church or your school or your place of employment. So I think we need to have greater education and buy-in from the community in order to learn the impact of this law and the benefits that are included in it, in order for them to educate fellow community members, rather than you having to go to a website or wait for a government mailing. That's not always a trusted source of information for many communities. And as a result, we need our community-based organizations to be involved in the process because of that. And there is funding included in this bill to do just that. In 2014, when the exchange is up and running, there will be specific outreach money dedicated to states and localities to be able to spread the word about what this law is actually going to mean for you.
Thank you. We have an email, and I'll go to Ms. Brooks first before we go to the next person on the right mic.
Our next question is from Teresa Berger, and she's from the Fox Chase Cancer Center in Philadelphia, Pennsylvania. Many of the educational opportunities funded by the federal government cater to, quote, young students. For instance, the current F-31 predoctoral grants are insufficient to support the financial needs of, quote, mature students. Will this gap be addressed in promoting mature minority students going into medicine, science, and research?
Who's ready for that one?
That's a great question. Well, one of the main things that this law does is it reauthorizes the Centers of Excellence program. Centers of Excellence program was created in the 2000 law that Dr. Whitehead included in his slide presentation that included the National Center for Minority Health and Health Disparities. Basically, these centers of excellence are located throughout the country, often at historically black colleges, at tribal colleges, at Hispanic-serving institutions, and often in inner city colleges such as the University of Illinois at Chicago. It's these centers of excellence whose mission it is to recruit and retain students of color, whether it be a mature reentry student or whether it be a high school student that's looking to go into an accelerated program that's going to go directly from undergrad to medical school. The idea is that it is their purpose to make sure that these students not only get into the programs but are successful once they're there, that they promote, have the resources and the training necessary to be able to succeed in these classes so that they can then go into primary care or a nurse professional or something like that.
Next person, state your name and your question, please, sir.
Good afternoon. My name is Alan Boynsey, and I have two parts to my question. The first part, I guess, is more for Ms. Alvarez and Dr. Whitehead. I've often heard, the rights to health care is just that. It's a right. It's not a privilege. And I know that but one concern of mine is how ex-felons, you know, people who have come out of prison would be affected by this health care reform bill. And I was just wondering, do you see, what kind of potential is there for maybe states to complicate that? Because I know certainly with the right to vote, you know, states are able to withhold that, you know, from ex-felons. So, you know, do you see any potential for states to complicate, health care for ex-felons as they, you know, maybe apply for jobs?
Great question, actually. And I think moving forward, one of the best things about this bill is that these health insurance exchanges, these marketplaces that are going to present us with our options for health insurance, are actually going to be operated at the state level. It's not going to be one federal government exchange, but each state is going to be able to craft that as they see fit and be able to possibly address the concern that you're discussing.
Okay. And Dr. Whitehead, do you have a
Yeah, I think that, you know, one of the points I was making earlier, I see healthcare reform as one more tool that we have that should provide us who are really interested in healthcare reform at the grassroots level to act, to work on these issues, et cetera. And with regards to reentry, I think that in prisoners, I think this is an urgent public health problem. And part of that, I define public health very broadly, affecting all quality of life issues. And you have these communities who have carried quite a burden, and now they had their people taken away, and now they're being sent back with these particular issues. There are some things happening around the country. I was shocked to read in the Post the other day that the governor of Virginia has appointed a person in charge of the issues of reentry, trying to also passing a bill to give people their rights back, from the felon status back to being citizens. These people themselves, when we talked to them, we started out with using words like reentrance even before that, I forget the words, but they want to be called returning citizens. Mm-hmm. So even within their language. So the whole idea of this conference focusing on this issue is to really pull the best ideas, the best strategies, et cetera, about how do we really return these people as citizens and to have them functioning as citizens. So I think that is in process as well, in terms of people are working on these issues.
Did you get both parts of your question? You have a second part.
Second part is for Dr. Whitehead, but I was only wondering if you could talk more about the community participatory research aspect of your work. I know you talked about focus groups, but how do you recruit individuals? Could you just talk a bit more about the kind of work you do there?
Yeah, part of what we do is that we try to help with the data they collect so that the participatory part of it, for example, one organization right now in DC that we are working with, they tell us what they want to do in terms of assessments and needs, what's topics, et cetera. We then try to, and this project, this program organization works with reentrants. They train reentrants to be HIV outreach workers within the community. And so there are some things that they want to know to further their program. So they identify the topics. Then we work with them on creating a design about how to go about collecting this data. Then what we plan to do with them is to train their health outreach workers to be community ethnographers, to collect the data in the community. And they become these sort of research assistants to us. And for us, it's like transferring our skills into the community itself. So this is one of the activities that we just started actually this summer with this particular project. But I'm very enthused with regards to where we're going to go.
Anybody else want to chime in? Yes.
We have this program that I mentioned earlier, the Urban Indian Health Institute, that we created back 10 years ago. And the whole foundation of that was this idea of how do we teach the community what research is, how to use research, and how to participate in research. Because the community has to participate in it to really make it effective. And so every single project that we have an advisory committee for. The community has an advisory stand on it. The fact that we're a nonprofit organization and not a university means we don't have to publish anything that happens. Because employment has nothing to do with publication, it has to do with doing good work for the community. The other thing that we've incorporated into our work is when we finish a project, we automatically go to the community first and release the information. Then the community decides how they want that information used. Sometimes it's published in publishable form in peer-reviewed journals. Sometimes it's just a report that's given to them, and then they can do whatever they want with it. Sometimes it's done in a whole variety of different ways. But again, the community drives how we distribute that information. And we've had lots of battles with CDC and NIH and other organizations around that because they say, no, we own that data. And I go, no, you don't. The community owns that data. And the community makes the decisions about that data. That's when people start becoming empowered. That's when the community starts really becoming engaged. And that's when community-based participatory research is really participatory. And I think, again, that's where communities need to start thinking about the fact that universities have great skills. They have great people who really have enormous things to provide for them. But the communities ultimately have to solve their own problems, because they're the ones that have the vested interest in solving those problems. They need the assistance of universities. They need the assistance of public health departments, state health departments, legislators, and everybody else. But until we teach them and especially encourage them and especially empower them to understand that they're the ones that have to be engaged in this process, then we're still preaching to them. We're not participating with them. And so that P in that you know, community-based participatory research, in my opinion, really has to come from the community, and we need to teach the community how to participate and to take leadership in that particular regard. So I think in some respects what we've tried to do is really use that as a model, and I think it's worked fairly well for us so far.
Excellent questions, and thank you very much. Now we have a question on the left mic.
Hi, my name is Betsy Havens. I'm here with the National Health Law Program. I actually got my master's in public health from UNC. Thank you all for being here for this important conversation. It's really appreciated. I'll be the first to admit that I am thrilled with the passage of the health care reform bill and the Obama administration's expanding insurance to the millions of Americans that need it. But I'm wanting to hear from you, what do you see as lacking in the health care reform bill as it relates to health disparities, or put another way, as advocates to eliminate health care disparities? What else would we like to see from Congress?
Ms. Alvarez, should we start in Washington?
I'm kind of biased.
Okay, Mr. Fakari, you yet.
I'll start out. I'm a single-payer advocate. The reason that I'm a single-payer advocate is I think it's the only way we can solve the real questions of health care in this country. As long as we have competing interests through insurance, there's always going to be winners and losers. And so I think that that's a deficiency in the health care bill that was currently passed. It also is a health insurance bill. It really doesn't address health. It addresses medical care, because that's where the cost is at right now. But medical care alone, I don't think, is the solution to the health care crisis in this country. I think we have to deal with poverty. I think we have to deal with inadequate education. I think we have to deal with jobs. I think we have to deal with all those other kinds of extenuating factors that contribute to poor health among our populations. You know, and we have to also deal with cultural differences and sociological differences and historical differences. I mean, there are some people, some communities that have for literally generations lived in poverty. How do you change that in a very short period of time? So my real concern is whether or not we have the energy and the willingness and the commitment to be able to follow through on the promise. I think this is a wonderful statement that the president and the Congress made, and the fact that they were able to accomplish something that has been tried for over 100 years and not been accomplished, I think we have to applaud that, and we have to make sure that we celebrate that. But we also have to realize that it was just a tiny first step, and that there are so many other things that we have to do if we're really going to try to deal with disparities in our population. Because disparities are more than just the tangibles that we see in statistics. There are these intangibles of cultural and history and racism and all the things that are difficult for people to talk about. But if we really want to solve the problem, we're going to have to talk about them. And I hope that this starts that conversation.
Well, we're coming very close to the end of our time, but we do have time for one email question, and I'll recognize Ms. Brooks.
Our last question of the day is coming from Donna King from Orange County Health Care Department in Hillsborough, North Carolina. And her question is, where does health care reform leave local public health departments?
I think local public health departments are going to continue to be a resource for our communities. I think right now, many states and localities are struggling with their budget situations. And like the federal government, everyone's trying to do more with less. I think this new law, by reforming our entire healthcare system, is basically going to level the playing field so that many of the uninsured aren't so dependent on local health departments and their tight resources, but that they're able to seek private health insurance and go see private doctors and hospitals so that local health departments can continue to focus on the community services that they're there for.
My answer is data, 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 data. Public health departments, state and local, have the ultimate responsibility in building data for uses in planning and uses in measuring these kinds of disparities and other kinds of indicators. And unfortunately, because of the financing situation, we've seen an erosion in local capacity to be able to collect data. They collect it on a macro scale, but not on a micro scale, which is what we really need. There was a question earlier about data, and I wanted to make a comment because up until just recently, American Indians were considered an other. If you're an other, you don't exist. And the whole theme of invisibility that I tried to bring out in some of my conversation was just that one of the reasons that we created the Institute again was the fact that people keep telling us there's no data on urban Indians, so you don't exist. And if you don't exist, then we don't need to take care of you. We don't need to give you resources. We don't need to do these things. So data, 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 helping health departments come up with strategies to get data at the community level, at the neighborhood level if necessary, and to identify all populations of people, not just throw them lump sum into big categories. There's lots of questions about that, about privacy and security and those kinds of things that we're going to have to tackle, but that's okay. We need to tackle those kinds of things. But if I were, you know, I think the public health departments have an enormous role to play in building that kind of data capacity to help us make decisions about the future of health in this country.
Very good points. The Affordable Care Act transforms the financing of health care, and it targets health disparities in other ways as well. But as our presenters have reminded us, this transformation is but one step on a long path. We are very grateful to our three guests and sponsors, and to you, of course, who've been watching and participating in this program, for making this discussion possible. I ask all of you if you agree with me that our participants have given us a lot to think about, to join with me in giving them a great big thank you for their contributions, for their expertise, for sharing their insight, and helping us work our way through understanding better this topic. Our participants, Ms. Myra Alvarez, Mr. Ralph Ficarra, and Dr. Tony Whitehead, join me in giving them a big round of applause. We'd also like to thank each of our sponsors for making this event possible. You will see their names on the screen at the conclusion of today's broadcast and can also find them on the Videoconference website. And finally, we would like to thank you who are here in the audience for participating, and for those of you who participated off-site, for making this program so informative and exciting. Tell your friends and colleagues that they can view the broadcast on our website starting as early as this evening. Just go to www.minority.unc.edu. Please also mark your calendars for the 13th annual William T. Small Jr. keynote lecture from the 32nd annual Minority Health Conference, which will be held on February 25th, 2011. And also mark your calendars for next year, when our annual Summer Public Health Research video conference on minority health will be held on June 7th, 2011. Thank you again for participating. I'm Howard Lee, hoping that you will always be well.
Thank you.